This series is in prelude to a science workshop meeting that we are holding next Monday and Tuesday. So it'll be a relatively quick turnaround time, but the intention here was that we could get a lot of this background stakeholder input information done before we got to the meeting in Leavenworth, Washington. So each one of these presentations are being recorded, and they will be posted to YouTube, not only for you to take a look at them, but so they remain sort of a long-term information piece as we develop our science plan. The science workshop on Monday and Tuesday, which will be in Leavenworth, Washington, and still has seats available in case anybody's interested. If you are, please send me an email and I'll get you the information. But that science workshop is going to be to kick off development of a 5-year science plan for the Great Northern LCC. It is a plan that we hope to accomplish and complete by January of 2014, and has important elements not only of content, some of which you're going to hear today, but a structure. The LCCs were all required to develop a science plan, and although it's never been done from an LCC perspective before, so Great Northern, as usual, is sort of out in the front, but we're walking down a blind road with our hands out in front of us. And so we appreciate you being part of the our science community here, and we look forward to your input both now in the form of questions and for the presenters, the things that they're going to say, and later on as we develop the science plan. We're always open to communication, and so please feel free to make sure that you are involved, and we will give you periodic updates even after the science workshop next week. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our four speakers today. We're going to start off with Steve Torbett, who's Associate Regional Director for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service Region 6 in Science Applications. And Steve's going to tell us about science priorities in the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service Mountain Prairie Region. We'll be followed up by a team effort between Peter Packett, who is with the Northwest Power and Conservation Council, an important conservation arm doing work in the Columbia Basin. And he will partner with Tom Iverson, who is with the Columbia Basin Fish and Wildlife Foundation. And following Tom and Peter, we will have a presentation by Leif Olson, who is with a consulting firm in Alberta that recently did a landscape level analysis and science needs assessment for an area in Alberta called the Oldman Watershed, and they took a much larger landscape approach, and we'll hear how that process went. But now I'd like to turn the presentation over to Stephen Torbett. Welcome, Stephen, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Sean, and thanks, everybody, for joining the webinar today. What I'd like to do today is to give everybody a sense of the regional science priorities for Region 6, the Mountain Prairie region of the Fish and Wildlife Service, the regional offices here in Denver. And some of these priorities are going to be rather large and thematic, but I will take the opportunity to drill down on a few of them that may be of a little bit more intense interest by the Great Northern science supporters. So we'll have a few slides here, and then hopefully leave some time for questions. I know the agenda is pretty busy today. So to begin with, I'd like to talk about the sort of the operational science priorities of the Fish and Wildlife Service. Of course, everything that we do is driven by science, and some of the things that I won't talk about today are a little bit more management oriented, but be aware that they're underpinned by science. So these three bullets on the first slide here are really those big operational science needs and priorities for the region. And the first one is to work with our partners to develop a surrogate species approach on a landscape level to facilitate conservation delivery and management and conservation success on the landscapes that we oversee in this region of the Fish and Wildlife Service. This is a paradigm shift for the Fish and Wildlife Service, and we've developed some guidance, but that guidance needs to be peer-reviewed, and so probably first part of June. That will be sent out to independent scientists for a peer review, and we will also be seeking the guidance of the peer reviewers in helping us develop the accompanying monitoring systems that will go along with trying to use the surrogate species approach, where we focus on a few species in order to bring conservation benefits to multiple species in a landscape. One of the really key parameters here is that we've developed a cooperative framework with our state counterparts, the state fish and wildlife agencies, to do this, and we've got a really good framework involved once the peer review have done is how to continue down this road. So that's one of the highest priorities for the service. And you can see the next operational priorities mentions LCCs. We want to continue to build the science capacity for the region through the LCCs. When folks across the region sit on steering committees for the LCCs, we want to be sure that they're well versed in some of the decision support tools, some of the basic research needs that the region has identified, and bring those along to the steering and the science and technical committees of the variety of LCCs in the region to make sure that those science needs and tool development needs are laid out for the all the various committees for the LCCs. So, you know, it's those first two priorities are really linked. And then, of course, that the LCCs are not the only place where we develop and utilize science for the region. And one of our really highly successful science components for the region are the HAPET, or the Habitat and Population Evaluation Team, that's currently housed in Bismarck, North Dakota, has done a lot of work with migratory waterfowl, really developed some good science-based management tools to drive conservation of waterfowl in the prairie pothole area. And one of the things that the region is looking at is bringing some of that skill and expertise to other issues, other opportunities across the region, so we can take advantage of that skill and those abilities, in addition to the waterfowl work, to look at applying some of those tools and techniques and people and expertise to some of the other science challenges that arise across the region. And then the other component of leveraging internal science capacity is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Refuge System has initiated an effort about the same time as the LCCs to really fund and improve the inventory and monitoring program within the refuge system. And again, the region is looking to expand the ability of those folks and their tools and abilities across the region and facilitate thinking on landscape scale conservation for surrogate species or other challenges that arise across the region during the year. And one thing I should say is this science and regional priority list is something that the regional director has signed off on, and so Noreen Walsh, our regional director, has endorsed this. So it comes, you know, with the momentum that builds up from having the full endorsement of the regional director. As you can imagine, because we have so many different kinds of programs, there's some details that are science priorities within some of the programs. So for the Threatened and Endangered Species Program, I've pulled a few of these out that will be of interest to the landscape conservation cooperatives. We're really emphasizing trying to place that high level of science support for blackfoot and ferret recovery. We're on the cusp of really changing the game for black-footed ferrets and prairie dog conservation. There's been a laboratory developed oral plague vaccine that we're going to continue to test and in the field to ensure the safety and that it's effective in a field situation, not just the lab. And then if that is successful, develop a delivery system for the the short grass prairie dog ferret community to really provide new opportunities across the West for ferret recovery. We're going to emphasize the revision of the Yellowstone demographic standards for the recovery plan and conservation strategy. We still are very interested in moving the Yellowstone population to a place where we can continue to advocate for delisting on that bear population, and there's a couple of scientific needs we've identified there, as well as finish the science underpinnings for the NCDE conservation strategy for those bears further north. We have some science needs that we've identified and prioritized with regard to recovery of Colorado River fish. We've got to continue the research and work with our state partners to verify and then implement a plan to control non-native fish. Most of these are sport fish that have been introduced to the system and are causing some serious constraints on the population recovery for the endangered fish. And given the pervasive drought in the West, we also have prioritized the development of interesting flow strategies coming out of Fleming Gorge and the Aspinall unit to assist in survival of juvenile endangered fish in the Colorado River. We've targeted a couple of landscape ecotypes that are going to be high priority for us, and these would, I think, correspond at least one of them to the eco partner forums that the Great Northern has developed. We want to continue to emphasize grassland-dependent species and native grassland ecosystems, continue to try and improve our efforts to conserve habitat for grassland nesting birds and improve the effectiveness of the breeding bird survey. We see the need increasing there in grassland birds. There are several populations of birds that continue to decline, and we need to develop more robust survey methodology and have that feed directly into our land protection efforts. And then some of the other areas that we're targeting have in the prairie region highlight the need to conserve prairie fish. And so you'll see that we have some targeted fish passage projects we want to understand and facilitate in the Flint Hills and the Sand Hills and in general in North and South Dakota. Finally, the landscape that may be most appropriate for the Great Northern is the sage steppe ecosystem. This region has the lead for the Fish and Wildlife Service in the range-wide assessment and the status review for greater sage grouse that's coming down the line for us. And we also are the lead for the inter-LCC sage grouse research effort, which is combining the power of the partners at the LCC level with the Great Northern, the Prairie Pothole, the Great Basin, and the Southern Rockies LCC. Finally, in that sage steppe ecosystem, we are trying to elevate and support as a priority the Strategic Watershed Action Team that is part of the Intermountain Joint Venture to develop the best use, the most scientifically robust use of the NRCS money for the sage grouse initiative. A couple other priority resources that we've indicated are important to focus science acquisition are for native salmonids. We really want to employ and determine the effectiveness of a habitat assessment tool that's been developed for maintaining and restoring connectivity and habitat enhancement for native salmonids in the mountainous part of the region. This would be a management experiment that we want to conduct and then step back and assess and see how effective it's been. And then, of course, we have with the energy development in the region, especially the burgeoning wind energy development. We're very interested in acquiring and supporting new science on golden eagle mortalities. We've actually, the service in general has developed a golden eagle mortality model that has been just recently peer-reviewed by some experts in the field, and so they've recommended some things that we need to do to improve the usefulness and veracity of that model. But there's a lot of work that we need to do to understand the interaction of golden eagles and really other raptors, but eagles are the species of highest priority right now in understanding mortality, movement patterns and productivity with the rapid development of wind energy in the region. Finally, taking a look into the future, we want to continue to focus on some existing environmental stressors, and of course energy development is such a huge issue for us, so we want to make sure that we can identify priority landscapes, priority habitat areas, and design conservation management of those areas for golden eagles and sage grouse. Given the development of energy in the region, it's a broad scale approach to really try and understand what areas we really need to maintain free or minimally developed for the benefit of those species, and then not stopping with what you know is staring us in the face right now, but to look into the future about what other potential stressors may be to wildlife and wildlife habitat, and try and anticipate what those future stressors may be, so that we're better able to prepare for their impacts and be ready to recommend fundamental understanding of mitigation efforts and decision support tool development. So that you know we're not behind the curve as wildlife folks so often are. So that's a really quick summary of the priorities for the region. And so I think Sean, I'll be able to take questions now if anybody has any questions.
Thanks very much, Stephen. I think many of you know, but if you don't, next to your name in that right-hand panel, you'll see a little symbol for a raise your hand. If you want to ask a question, raise your hand using that panel, and Leslie will unmute you, and you can ask your question by voice. So let's have those questions for Stephen.
I'm not seeing any hands raised yet. Oh, there we go. Tom Olive has a question. All right, Tom, you're on.
Hey, Leslie, thanks. Steve, thanks for the presentation. Just wondering if this is a if this represents the and you know sort of all the divisions in the Fish and Wildlife Service in the Mountain Prairie region, or if this is mostly focused on science applications, and if so, if there are other funding that's going to come in for some of these projects, which I think people are going to be very interested in.
Well, it's really a broad overview of the region and the various programs. This isn't really focused entirely on science applications, but that first slide with some of the operational priorities, that's really something that is going to be emphasized to me and the science application shop as we go forward. In terms of funding, there is additional support at the Washington level to direct resources to target some of these questions and these needs that are identified not just at our region but in other regions. So for example, in looking at the West, in looking at the Mountain Prairie region, the Albuquerque, California, and Portland region, so you look at the West as a whole, this idea or concern about energy development and its consequences to raptors and in a lot of the West sage grouse is a common theme. So there's been an effort by the Fish and Wildlife Service to redirect some funding, some of our existing funding, to those efforts, not just because it's a priority for this region. In addition, we were meeting early this morning, this regional office was meeting early this morning with the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation talking about some of these very high priority science needs that we have and trying to build momentum with NIFWF to help us find partners to get some of this work done. Not that we, the Fish and Wildlife Service, have the capacity or ability to do all this work, but recognizing that as a priority and with the partnerships that we have across the LCCs, that there are many people out there that potentially could help us develop this information, develop the decision support tool, developing new monitoring protocols so that our mission is fulfilled and we can work with NIFWF and some of its corporate and other federal partners to find the money to support that work.
Great. Thanks, Steve.
Okay, any other questions for Steve? Please raise your hand.
I think Steve might be off the hook until later.
Okay. Well, actually, I have one question, Steve, because I was curious about your discussion about black-footed ferret, which, you know, they range in a portion of the Great Northern LCC, and they're obviously a high-priority species being listed and such. What's your perspective on how we deal with those kinds of species that have a relatively restricted range, you know, within the 1.1 million square kilometers of the Great Northern, and how much of that is sort of an LCC focus, or should we sort of drive or participate in partnerships?
I guess I think that's a really good question, Sean, and I think my perspective on that is that each LCC could take a look at the black-footed ferrets as a species of high priority for the Fish and Wildlife Service, but do a really quick assessment of the ability of the Great Northern, say, to contribute meaningfully to the recovery of the black-footed ferret, and especially comparing the Great Northern to the Prairie Pothole LCC and the Great Plains LCC. I think the opportunities for recovery are much bigger and much broader in those other LCCs, and so I would suggest that as those other LCCs develop their science priorities and their conservation priorities, that something like a ferret would rank higher with them than it would be with the Great Northern. And should an opportunity present itself with the Great Northern, say the state of Wyoming or the state of Montana, would want to engage at a site that would be within the landscape of the Great Northern, then the Great Northern could participate and maybe facilitate the conducting of one of these field experiments for the efficacy and safety of the vaccine. But I really think that compared to the opportunities that are available with the other LCCs, the Great Northern should not necessarily consider that a high science or conservation priority.
Very good, thanks. Any other questions for Stephen? Okay, Stephen, sounds like you are off the hot seat. Thanks very much for your presentation, and be wary that you are still open to follow-up questions, and your presentation will be on YouTube, as on all of these, so you're going to be famous.
Okay, all right.
Thank you very
much. Thank you, guys.
Yep, thanks, and now we'll switch over to presenters from the Columbia Basin. We have Peter Paquette. Peter, are you on the line?
I'm here.
Okay, very good. And Tom Iverson. So Peter is with the Northwest Power and Conservation Council, and Tom Iverson is with the Columbia Basin Fish and Wildlife Foundation. They're going to give us some information about science needs in the Columbia Basin. It looks like Peter has control, and So welcome and thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you, and I hope we can all hear. I'm sort of doing this in a hotel room in Canada, but everything seems to be working. So
we can hear you just fine.
Okay, thanks. I think just as a little bit of a background, I think it's probably appropriate here, and that is sometimes people want to know who the council is and what do we cover. So we were created by Congress in 1980 through the Pacific Northwest Electric Power and Conservation Act. And essentially, we do two major things. One is we create the power plan for the Pacific Northwest region, essentially the Bonneville Service Territory, which is Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Montana, with a little bits of Wyoming and some Nevada and other, but essentially those four states. There are four council members, or eight council members, excuse me, two from each state that are appointed by the governors and approved by the legislature. But beyond just the power planning side, which is another whole issue here, we also do the develop the Columbia River Basin Fish and Wildlife Program, and we're directed by Congress to do this as part of that fish and wildlife mandate. And with that particular program, we are asked to work with, or I guess mandated to work with, all of the state and federal fish and wildlife agencies and all of the Columbia River tribes, recognized tribes. So that's nowadays 16 different tribes that we also work with. And you can see on the screen, this is essentially the area that we work in. I just mentioned that we do have some number of transboundary projects, so we work also a bit on the Canadian side. And in much of our planning that we've done, we've also tried to work with the Canadian portion of the basin. Go to the next slide here. Program is basically, we have three levels that we try to look at things. Again, we're looking at the entire Columbia, so the Act basically does tell us that we are to be doing this as a system-wide approach. And within there, we've developed a process where we have a vision, a scientific foundation, biological objectives, and then strategies. Essentially, we try to carry those through throughout the whole program. To make things easier to work with, we've also divided the basin up into what we call 11 ecological provinces. These are essentially focused along hydrologic units. We had found that in the past there had been other attempts to divide things up into provinces, but they were often formulated more around political boundaries, whether it been Forest Service, national forest boundaries or counties or other things. Our focus is to move this to more of a biological aspect, and so we focused on using these based on hydrologic data. Then for each of the provinces, we've divided those into the sub-basins, which we recognize 62 sub-basins and some main stem reaches within the Columbia system. And those are generally the big tributaries. So it would be like things like the Deschutes River, the John Day, the Yakima, the Grand Ronde, et cetera, as being sub-basins of the Columbia. And what the map essentially shows you the way we have now broken it out into those various basins. Unfortunately, on this map, I always hate this, is that it's typical of the U.S. maps, is that it seems to think that the basin disappears at the 49th parallel, which is not true. And as I said, we've now working, when we did the sub-basin planning, which we'll talk about, we did include the Canadian portions of the basin. As part of the program, we've developed a set of scientific principles. These are were essentially done through a process several years ago, which we called the multi-species framework process, where we worked with various managers and entities, including utilities, fish and wildlife agencies, tribes, and others, through a process to try to come up with a essentially and our independent science panels to come up with a set of what we thought were appropriate principles that should be applied across the basin. And these are pretty, I think everybody will recognize, these seem to be, fairly broad, but I think they're important in establishing sort of the principles to how we were going to manage the program. And I don't know that I need to go through all of these in detail. I think you can read through them as easily, but I think there's some important ones. I think we still recognize particularly abundance and productivity and diversity are really the real characteristics that we want to see, that we want to look at when we're looking at this from an ecosystem standpoint. I think just the idea that we've got to recognize that these ecosystems are going to be dynamic, they're going to change over time. This becomes particularly more important now as we start looking at the effects of climate change and other such things. Recognize that all of these systems operate at a different spatial and time scales, and that we can do some organization in a hierarchical manner. We recognize that habitats develop and are maintained by physical and biological processes. And I think, again, that's an important one, is that we have to recognize is that the habitats are not constant. We're going to see changes, and that in many cases the changes are driven by species functions. And this is the way we would say that species play key roles in developing and maintaining each ecological condition. This was the carry out of some work that I think was originally put together by the U.S. Forest Service and Fish and Wildlife Service in looking at the key ecological functions that various species perform, and recognizing that those functions that the species form generally help shape the environment. Look at biological diversity to allow ecosystems to persist, particularly because of this environmental variation. We recognize that this is going to have to be adaptive and experimental. We'll get into that a little more, because I think the adaptive management idea is one of the driving forces in our particular program. And also that ecosystem function, habitat structure, and biological performance are affected by human actions. And that's partly say humans also have functions that they carry out, and those functions can, as we all know, alter and shape the various habitats. I mentioned the adaptive management. I think it's important since just about the beginning, council, with the help of some council members and working with it was Buzz Hollings and Carl Walters at the University of Washington and the University of British Columbia. Early on, we adopted the concept of adaptive management, particularly because we were dealing with the very large scale system. We recognized that there was a lot of uncertainty within particularly scientific uncertainty as to what actions were going to be the appropriate actions. We also recognized that we needed to be able to move forward and not be paralyzed by the fact that we didn't have all of the answers. So we tried to do is emphasize is that what we are doing is experimental, and that the program elements, projects that need to be designed in a way that they're treated as experiments. We're testing hypotheses, and that we need to be able to have the information that's needed to be able to adapt over the long term. So we do have some review processes we go through. We actually update the Columbia River Basin Fish and Wildlife Program, which we're responsible for approximately every 5 years, and of course try to make the changes that are necessary based on what we've learned during the preceding years. The other piece now that I really want to talk about is I think the efforts that I guess we've had to go through as the program has evolved, but to, in order to really have an effective adaptive management program and the type of monitoring and evaluation that's needed, particularly at a very high level, let's say the landscape level, because we're looking at an area of close to 259,000 square miles, and trying to look at it as a system. And just sort of a little bit of a history here is that they, certainly early on, I think before 1997, the first program went into effect in 1982. But the real emphasis was in the beginning was to look at what was going on in the main stem, and that was making changes in how we operate and putting different structures into dams. But how we operate the hydro system and many of the things that affect fish at the dams, those seem to be the critical issues that we moved on fairly quickly. But during that period, we were able to have some monitoring and evaluation of those specific sort of actions, but generally at the level of each project. And really, to get any kind of an adaptation in here, we were fairly limited in that kind of monitoring or evaluation. But we simply took that, reviewed projects, council made recommendations to Bonneville Power Administration, who is the funder. BPA provides the funding for the program through ratepayer dollars, and then more on to an implementation. So it wasn't a very elaborate or I guess not the model that I think we really envision for a strong adaptive management approach. As we move forward, beginning in about 2000, we did add a few other things into the monitoring and to the review process. And a couple of those were, one was an amendment to the Act that created the Independent Science Review Panel, which is a panel. It's made up of scientists that the National Academy of Sciences gives us a list of scientists who they feel are qualified. We then pick from those the panel. In all projects that we basically recommend or that where Bonneville dollars are being used now must go through an independent science review. And that there's a feedback then both to the project managers. In most cases, there's at least an opportunity after they've been reviewed to basically make changes based on the science review. And then make recommendations back to the council as to what changes may be made or which projects would continue to move forward. At the same time, we've also had established an independent scientific advisory board, and they look at major issues, essentially. So there are a number of major scientific issues that are out there, and including looking at the concept and I guess the science behind the whole program. And they provide us, well, they've just provided us, for example, with a review of the program and made recommendations as we're about to enter another amendment process where we'll be updating the program. Hope to have that completed by 2014. Again, as we've continued to move forward and tried to improve both the planning and the way we monitor these things, one of the things that we looked at, and it was based on the comments that came from the independent science panels, was the need to have, I guess, a better idea of what was occurring at each of the sub-basins, a way to look at these in greater detail and to have a better planning process. And one of the comments that came back from the early reviews by the independent science teams, it was very difficult for them to see. They could look at a specific project and see how that project might be valuable by itself, but to question that they often ask was, well, but how does it fit in to that particular sub-basin as a whole? Does it address the limiting factors that are within in that? And are there priority reaches that have been identified that need to be focused on? And in particular, what are the focal species within those particular sub-basins that we're interested in? And so carried out that process, completed those all six sub-basin plans for all of the sub-basins within the Columbia River, and those were adopted into the most recent version, the 2009 version of the Fish and Wildlife Program. And those sub-basin plans were essentially developed at the local level with the assistance of fish and wildlife agencies and tribes, but it was a much more bottom-up approach than we'd seen in the past. And I think that was really a valuable lesson because all those plans were subject to having to go through science review. There were revisions that had to be made, but in the end, I think they did quite well. And one of the things we're looking for there was a better way to get the local buy-in to the various projects and strategies that were trying to be employed in those levels. And I think, you know, the jury is still out, but I think things have been much more successful. It's also provided a greater benefit to the science review panels and being able to look at projects and seeing how they fit in with a particular sub-basin plan. At the same time we were doing that, we also looked at the main stem. It's hard to put the river into a particular sub-basin, but the same concept between the major reaches of the Columbia. And just to sort of summarize here, so until 2009, our primary focus has been really to get projects on the ground and try to get them into the right places. We still had that question, and I think it's one that's going to come up over and over, is are these making, by putting these individual projects in and looking at each of those, and they all or individually may be valuable, but the question is, what are they contributing at that higher level, at that landscape level, particularly if we have to answer questions, is this basin, this entire Columbia Basin, are we seeing improvements? So it was really time, as we looked in more recently, to focus on beyond just projects, but how do we answer those questions? So one thing we began is to sort of an annual reporting process, which tries to go through and look at everything that's been done and kind of summarize it. And that originally, I think, came up with the status of the resources report that's been put out for a couple of years. And so that kind of is another element that we began to add to more onto the results side. And then created a feedback loop between that and a particular topic that may be of high priority in a particular year. But getting that back to the Independent Science Advisory Board so that we could get their feedback on the particular topic of concern, you're generally at a fairly high level. Other pieces that we began to add in is status and trends monitoring, or the idea that we need to get that in there. There are a number of pieces that were happening there. And just as you see, we've added now other steps, and I think one of the more key ones and important as we try to answer these questions at that higher level is the development of a concept of what are the high-level indicators that we can look at, recognizing that there are literally hundreds of indicators at the individual project level, but what are the high-level indicators that we need to be focusing on that can help us answer the questions at that landscape level. And again, the idea then is that with these various components is then we can essentially actually begin to identify where the key gaps are and where the redundancies are that help us to then better redefine, I think, the program. And again, going back to the concept of adaptive management, I think, these are kind of principles that we kind of came up with, is that as much as possible, use other people's information to compile maps, tables, and graphs. And there's a tremendous amount of information that's being produced in this basin by various agencies, tribes, utilities, others, all of which can be valuable if we can extract the right pieces out of it, that information that helps us answer these higher level questions. Production of annual summary reports is probably critical to getting the information out there. And as I said, identifying the data and coverage graphs, gaps, I think those are always important as we try to answer these questions. I think we continually find that there are gaps in our knowledge, and some of them may be critical gaps, and we need to figure out how to fill those gaps. And then trying to limit new monitoring out in evaluation and shifting forces and resources more toward the higher priority gap filling. I think one thing we found is that we require monitoring and evaluation on every project, but do we need down to the gnat's eyebrow sort of information on every single project when we may have multiple projects in a single basin that are addressing very similar sorts of things? We may be able to get the kind of information we need without having to spend literally millions of dollars on every individual project. So that's a real struggle trying to make that change. So ultimately, I think what we've also added in there is the importance of having what we call a science and policy exchange, and particularly picking again these topics of high concern, bringing the region together perhaps once a year, maybe every 18 months or so. But to really sit down and focus on particular issues so that there's an exchange of information that goes on among all of the players that are participating in the program. Science review is critical. We feel that it's one of the things that I think allows us to have, I think, high quality projects. Is the fact that we do have a fairly rigorous scientific review process. There are a number of areas, of course, that that we need to really focus on. This RM&E project review is a critical one. Another area in terms of science that's getting a lot of scrutiny at this point is hatcheries and artificial production, particularly with the effect on wild fish versus hatchery fish. We've had the Hatchery Scientific Review Group, science teams making recommendations on changes for hatchery reform, better handles on data management, particularly how do you bring in all these multiple sources of data, how do you get that in with the various managers, and all of the other kind of questions that go along with that, and focusing on better metrics and for habitat monitoring. Again, there's a number of gaps that we've seen out there, ocean, the estuary, the plume, research in there. There's areas that certainly we recognize from the beginning that the ocean plays a huge role, but I think there has always been sort of a lack of knowledge, and we're beginning to get a much better handle and focus, putting resources into understanding the ocean and the estuary and the plume, which are critical, of course, for salmon. And habitat monitoring workshops, the fish tagging forum, which is trying to address the issues of we spend literally millions of dollars each year on different fish tagging strategies, either using PIP tags or coated wire tags or other external marking, trying to get a better handle on that. And same thing with the wildlife. We do have a portion of the program does address wildlife needs, and establishment or reestablishment of wildlife advisory committees. We now have over 500,000 acres that we have purchased or in easements for wildlife mitigation. Why are we all doing this? I guess it's the we're trying to use this high-level reporting to kind of set the context for why actions are implemented and provide the ability to evaluate the context these contributions to the greater whole. And I think, to be real honest, it's because the kind of questions that are being asked at the national scale and other things, and if you're going back and using ratepayer dollars and other things, the questions are going to be asked. Is the Columbia River system better now than it was after we spent who knows how many, hundreds of millions, billion of dollars on these various actions? We think the idea of a scaled framework allows for adding up and drilling down as we perform these analyses. As I said, we have this hierarchical approach, but the idea is the types of actions and the monitoring that takes place at each level should be done in a way that it can be rolled up to the next level. And also then provides us the capability to perform the adaptive management functions. I think that's the end of my presentation.
Thanks very much, Peter. I offered Tom Iverson a chance to add anything you'd like to say, Tom?
Sure, I'll just throw in a few quick things. So I'm with the Columbia Basin Fish and Wildlife Foundation. For the last 14 years, I've coordinated the Fish and Wildlife Manager's input into the development of the program, coordinating their ideas and thoughts and getting that contributed into the council's development of their framework and infrastructure. And so just in the context of this conversation for the Great Northern as a science framework, just a couple observations. One is the importance of that science policy interchange. That's really where the adaptive management happens, right? You're getting your science into your policymakers. You're having that conversation, and then policies change through informed presentations. The other important aspect that we've learned through this, we started out just funding projects, and then finally we did some bottom-up context planning, putting those projects into context in their location. And then we finally now gotten up enough, developed enough information that adding up all of those sub-basins, now we've got a program plan. They all add up to a very comprehensive program. But the point about the science piece of that is as you move up the pyramid from a science point, your science at the bottom is your basic research, that kind of stuff. But as you move up the pyramid and you're trying to build a science framework for a very large landscape scale, your science framework becomes information management, tying together various databases, assembling information so that you're learning on a scale that your policies are implemented at. And so that's something we've really learned, and we're really just getting, after 30 years of implementing this program, where from day one, adaptive management was the battle cry. 30 years later, we're just getting to the point of having the ability to actually make that happen at the highest level. And so I think it's been a successful program, but there's still a lot more to learn. But I just want to sort of emphasize the importance of looking at the scale that you're trying to set your policies at, coordinate your activities at, and matching the appropriate scale of science to that. And then the higher up you get, it's really about managing information and aligning data sets and getting agreement on how to share the data and what data fits together and what doesn't. So, but that's just my two cents very quickly. So I think Peter did a great job with the presentation. Thanks.
Well, thanks for those important contributions, Tom, and thank you, Peter, as well. I like your reference to the battle cry, Tom, and I can hope to indicate that the Great Northern LCC will be the reserve regiment in there. After your 30-year battle, you must be weary, so you'll have some reinforcements. I'd like to open it to any questions that anybody, any of the attendees might have. Again, you ask a question by raising your hand in that column right next to your name in the right-hand side panel. So So we'll give a minute for folks to raise their hands, and then Leslie will unmute you, and she'll tell you when it's time to ask your question.
I'm not seeing any hands flying in the air at this time.
Anybody, any questions for Peter or Tom? Okay, well, similar to Stephen before, thanks very much, Peter and Tom. Great presentation. We will include that not only in our webinar, in our YouTube channel, but we will also go back and reference that over the course of the next year as we develop that five-year science plan. So so you're not off the hot seat yet. You're just off for today. Thanks very much for your presentation. And we will now switch over in geographies to Alberta, to southern Alberta. And we welcome Leif Olson. Leif, I'll let you introduce yourself.
Hi there, folks. Yeah, this is Leif Olson here from O2 Planning and Design out of Calgary. With me is Caitlin Smith, who's also been heavily involved in the research and creation of the report that I've been asked to sort of step through. So we're going to take it in turns to sort of step through some of the results. We were asked a few months back to conduct a sort of broad-scale, multi-jurisdictional, multi-factor assessment of the influence of landscape patterns on environmental quality, and the sort of get up to date and summarize the sort of current state of research in terms of the use of remote sensed or spatial landscape patterns and how they might relate and how they've been shown to relate to environmental quality, basically at a wide variety of scales. Although we're certainly based out of Alberta, we did try and cast a pretty broad net here to really capture findings from a broad variety of sources across North America at a variety of scales, from the sort of mesoregional broad scales to much finer site level scales. And you know, basically we were looking to summarize and review literature from both the published academic literature as well as established gray literature and other publications, looking at studies that had found significant relationships between land use pattern and associated environmental quality indicators, and as well as to identify any potential thresholds of environmental quality that were associated with distinct land use and land cover patterns. So over the course of this review, we looked at about 650 publications, and of those, found 172 to be, you know, worthwhile for a more thorough and in-depth analysis. Of those, about 61% were biodiversity-related, and 32% water quality and quantity studies that we came across. And you know, from that, you know, we tried to distill some of the take-home messages, some of the potential confounding factors that spring up when you're conducting sort of fairly coarse remote sensing or landscape pattern-based approaches, and then looking at you know, what are the real strong findings going forward. And you know, this was sort of basically entered into looking at being a living document. You know, with 172 publications is hardly the full spread of all the research that has been done across a, you know, admittedly a very broad field. But we felt that the papers we selected really did capture a lot of the current thinking, current findings for you know, landscape pattern analysis. So basically, I mean, the primary finding I would say that came out of this is that notion that cover or composition and configuration are closely related metrics when you're looking at the landscape scale. And so that tends to be quite a confounding factor in a lot of scientific research in this sort of field, because it's very difficult to necessarily tease out the effect of habitats or cover amount and composition from the actual configuration of that land cover. And that often proves problematic in a lot of studies in terms of obscuring or masking or confounding results. But a typical result is one that Flather and Bevers found, which was basically the driving factor behind a lot of ecological factors, including population size and species persistence and things like that, that habitat amount really is the driving factor for a lot of cases. And it's only after you get down, after you start comparing landscapes that have suffered a great deal of habitat loss, or where habitats are just, rarely distributed across the landscape, when the percentage habitat under study is below, 30-40%, that's generally when you start seeing the signs of the effect of configuration. So that can often be a problem with a lot of studies, just really not having the power to detect the effect of certain confounded factors like this. So we kind of split the project up into two different components in that case. We looked at land cover indicators, which includes habitat amount, but also from a broader biodiversity or environmental quality perspective, land cover in general is sort of a broader term, I suppose, that plays here. And then having assessed that, we then turned our attention to the sort of more configuration indicators of landscape composition overall. But looking first of all at land cover, a lot of the studies, a lot of the results that you find really are quite fundamentally driven by how you go about defining cover types. These are often treated in studies as being quite Boolean, yes/no, hard-edged boundaries. And as we know, it's rare in a natural setting to really see hard-edged boundaries. Like we would treat them in a database or a landscape ecological study, and so a great deal of the influence of these cover types really does come down to how you go about defining them. So sometimes this will be due to the specific focus of the study. Sometimes it will be a function of the means that the studies use to assess cover types or make observations, and others will simply just be due to available data quality. So things like wetland cover, forest cover, and grassland cover are typically used in studies as assessments of natural cover, and whether or not they're treated individually or singly, or whether they're treated as part of a larger heterogeneic landscape cover type really controls what kinds of indicators and what kind of metrics people are using to study these things. So wetlands especially tend to really be quite dependent on the data that goes into defining them. Some studies use very fine scale LIDAR type data. Others are really, trying basically based on satellite imagery, and therefore can be quite coarse. And it really comes down to the thresholds or the classification used to define wetland in the first place. Forest cover, on the other hand, is often a lot of studies that are based on ABI or forest stand inventory metrics tend to have a lot greater wealth of information to draw on, and therefore tend to be a little more robust or a little more complex in the means that they use to evaluate forest cover. Grassland cover, again, and this is really, I think, strongly driven by the scale of the analysis. If very broad scales, grassland tends to be classified using remote sensed imagery and tends to be quite confounded between natural grassland types or more anthropogenic pasture land or cropland types. And so I think this really does tend to confound when you're comparing across a lot of studies. The definitions of what constitutes grassland can vary quite substantially. And whereas when you're dealing with smaller scale studies, they tend to be more vegetation and diversity driven in terms of actually having plots on the ground and things like that, which gives a little more robust classification, but it means you can't conduct those studies over the broad scale. And then finally, these last two types, impervious surface and agricultural land use cover, they're not used to assess habitat per se, but are more used to assess the magnitude of human impact in the area and the extent of disturbance that organisms or the environment in that area might be experiencing. And so it's sort of the flip side to land cover classifications. There's the suite of cover types that are associated with natural processes or natural cover or natural habitat, and then there's the suite of cover types associated with human activities. And so those are sort of two of the broad classifications across the field, I'd say. With regards to wetland cover, the major significant findings we found was that there's a pretty strong relationship between the proportion of the landscape or the watershed that is classified as wetland. There's a strong relationship between that proportion and indicators for water quality, flood control, and biodiversity. And that's been found, across the board in a lot of studies, even with fairly disparate methods, the results do tend to agree that wetland cover proportion cover is really quite a strong factor at play in these features. Now, one thing that makes wetlands quite distinct from a lot of other types of cover is just that they really do the function or the impact of the wetland is very dependent on their position in the landscape in terms of what areas are contributing water to them and where they contribute in turn. Small wetlands distributed across the landscape tend to be quite important despite the fact that their proportion might be fairly small. They often serve as stepping stones for biodiversity. They serve as refugia for native plant and animal species that might not be surviving elsewhere in the landscape, and stepping stones in turn between other large natural wetland complexes. And really, wetlands are a great example of a kind of cover that really you really do need to take into account their spatial configuration, especially in areas where they're really not found in a high proportion. You'll get a much greater effect or a beneficial effect of wetland cover if it's not just aggregated in a small portion of the landscape. You tend to get more impact when it's widely distributed across a variety of areas, contributing towards water quality and habitat amount throughout the area. So generally, target-wise, we're finding a surface, in terms of surface water quality, somewhere between 3 to 7% of the total landscape is required to be wetland for a lot of the Midwest, especially in order to see improved water quality in that watershed. And biodiversity and overall water quality tends to require even more of that. Certainly, that's what we're finding here in Alberta, is that we're looking at, you know, 7 to 15% of the landscape is really, you know, about where you want to be if you want to see some strong effects on biodiversity and water quality. In terms of forest cover, again, strong effects on water quality due to its control of overland flow and uptake and nutrient retention. And we did see some interesting papers that were actually linking that to water treatment costs and in terms of an ecosystem goods and services approach, although we didn't really focus on that approach here in terms of evaluating natural cover from a economic perspective. We really were focusing more on environmental quality over, you know, human use. And forest fires themselves can have a variety of effects, and they often tend to have sort of delayed temporal effects. You'll initially get quite a high boost to water nutrient availability and sediment loading, and that really does change over time as you move from you know, the forest fire itself to the regrowth. You know, so there's quite a dynamic effect there. So again, from a water quality perspective, we are finding that, you know, a forest cover of 25% or so really seems to be a strong driver for water quality. And depending on the kinds of habitat you're studying, it can require, you know, obviously require even greater amounts on that. In terms of grassland cover, you know, it really does come down to the strength of the association between the species and the grassland cover type. You know, many area-sensitive birds and mammals require a high percentage of grassland cover. The trouble with grassland, with native grassland, certainly in North America, is that we simply don't have very much of it. So it's highly correlated with anthropogenic disturbance and introduced species and the like. And so it can be hard to, you know, conduct a broad-scale assessment of the impact of native grassland cover just because of the tendency for it to be associated with so much else. But certainly looking at natural fire regimes, you know, these have been found to be essential to maintain those natural habitat conditions. You know, some studies have found the grazing practices can mimic the impacts of fire regimes, but in general, you know, grassland does seem to require a fairly consistent amount of disturbance in order to maintain the distribution proportion of species and you know, small environmental niches that vary over a fairly small stretch of area. And basically, you know, it really comes down, especially with grassland, it comes down to how they compare to other natural or anthropogenic cover types in terms of, you know, whether or not the grassland is being considered from an animal's perspective to be quality habitat. You tend to have much greater ranges over which disturbance can have an impact. The grassland cover targets really has to come down to the kinds of species you're studying and the kinds of environmental effects you're interested in maintaining. If you're dealing with species that are fairly generalist, you know, I mean, many are just looking for sort of topological or topographical arrangements of features. But whereas others really are quite dependent on natural native grassland species. In terms of impervious surface, it really is a big driver of a lot of reduction in native environmental quality. And it really comes down both to changes in water regimes, as you have a lot more overland flow, less absorption into the soil, more trace chemicals associated with that. But as well, it is also highly correlated with a variety of other anthropogenic factors, which is a big driver as well. So here, strong effects, but it's hard to tease out exactly the mechanisms behind them in some cases. And then agricultural or other human land use covers have been, again, shown to be very strongly strong drivers of environmental quality, both from EGS type services like pollination, as well as habitat quality and amount, predation amounts, and things like that. It's a strong factor. Again, a lot of this really comes down to how the individual studies define their land use cover and the kind of data that they're actually including in the analysis as to whether an area is really being assessed for anthropogenic impact. So I'm going to switch gears and let Caitlin discuss some of the more configuration-based indicator results.
Hi. I'm going to pick up where Leif left off. He was talking more about landscape cover indicators, and I'm going to switch over to landscape configuration indicators. And I wanted to reiterate one of the major findings that Leif pointed out in the beginning of this presentation, that cover and configuration are very highly correlated. So when oftentimes a landscape reaches certain thresholds of habitat loss or cover amount drops below a certain percentage, that's when landscape configuration becomes a really important driver of environmental quality. So when we talk about configuration, we're generally referring to the diversity in pattern, spatial arrangement, and types of land uses and vegetation communities in a landscape. And so this diagram that's up right now is kind of a simplified yet scientifically based demonstration of patterns in a landscape that can generally be roughly recognized as patches, corridors, networks made up of corridors and patches within a background matrix. And these more basic components build on each other in the landscape, and that in turn affects how ecosystems function differently from landscape to landscape. So when you have a fragmentation in a landscape, that can change the shape and size of these different components, and that will in turn affect the environmental quality of certain landscape features. So the configuration indicators I'm going to touch on in the following slides include fragment indicators of fragmentation and connectivity, which are very related to each other, corridor systems, patch size, core area and edge, and landscape heterogeneity. So first, talking about fragmentation and connectivity. Fragmentation refers to the degree to which vegetation communities are broken apart into smaller isolated sections within a landscape. This generally is a result of land use, and it often works in tandem with habitat loss. Connectivity, on the other hand, is a contiguity condition in a landscape in which patch elements can flow uninterrupted across the landscape. So we have two diagrams below. The one on the left is a diagram of a highly intact patch network. And the second one on the right illustrates the landscape that's been fragmented by a road, thus thereby reducing the connectivity. So in our literature review, we found many, many significant findings relating fragmentation to changes in environmental quality. Among some of the more significant findings, we found that fragmentation can result in demographic changes in plant animal populations. And when fragmentation exceeds certain habitat suitability thresholds for certain species, this can often result in extinction. In terms of water quality, fragmentation, small streams are most susceptible or most vulnerable to fragmentation. And so the water quality provisioning ecosystem services that they provide are also vulnerable to fragmentation via diversion, channelization, and elimination in oftentimes in urban and agricultural environments. So we found several targets and thresholds in many studies, which are kind of listed out in this shortened table. I just wanted to touch on a few of these in the table. In a study in northern Utah, for example, we found that American martens were very affected by timber harvest, and that natural openings, either man-made or natural, shouldn't exceed greater than 25% of the landscape for these animals to survive. Similar fragmentation can affect forest-dwelling birds. In a study in Quebec, we found that the birds were reluctant to cross gaps in the forest greater than 50 meters. So this can be used in a planning context in order to conserve forest-dwelling birds to try to keep gaps in the landscape to under 50 meters. Next, I'll talk a little bit about corridor systems, which we broke apart into three different indicators. We found many studies relating to riparian corridors or stream buffers, which have implications for water quality and connectivity in the landscape. We found lots of studies on shelter belts or windbreaks, which have implications for erosion and water and air quality, and linear disturbances, which are highly related to fragmentation. So linear disturbances, while we looked at studies that were related to seismic lines and pipelines, we primarily focused on roads because they are such a widespread disturbance everywhere in the world. First, looking at riparian corridors and stream buffers. These are vegetated zones or bands of permanent vegetation in a landscape located between aquatic resources and adjacent human land uses. The ideal size for buffers varies with management goals. For example, if conserving wildlife is the goal, a wider stream buffer is usually necessary, but it can be narrower if the goal is solely to protect water quality. We found several studies supporting a threshold of 5 to 10 meters. Buffers less than 5 to 10 meters provide little protection in a landscape for aquatic resources under most conditions. We also found that continuous riparian buffers correlates with higher overall watershed water quality, which isn't surprising. It also relates to higher aquatic diversity. Additionally, riparian buffers play a very important role in managing nitrogen uptake in watersheds. For example, in one study by Mayer, down at the bottom, in the bottom row of the table there, found that buffers over 50 meters were consistently more effective in removing nitrogen at the riparian zone than buffers that were narrower than that. Looking at shelter belts or windbreaks, these are important linear landscape features composed of lines of trees or other vegetation that are generally used in agricultural contexts to control erosion. We looked at how they affected and controlled erosion in a landscape, but also how they filtered odors in agricultural landscapes. So a couple thresholds that we found relating to shelter belts or windbreaks is that shelter belts between 6 and 10 meters high generally serve as an adequate buffer to reduce odors from nearby animal operations. Also, in terms of erosion protection, a single row of plantings is equally as effective as multiple rows of plantings. All right. Linear disturbances. We had many, many, many studies for this because it's such a great disturbance in the landscape that affects environmental ecosystem processes. Linear disturbances such as roads can create high contrast edges in the landscape through fragmentation. In general, most mammals, fish and birds are negatively affected by increasing road density in a given landscape. And this was found in many, supported by many studies. Bird abundance and breeding success is also affected by the density of roads in a landscape, which has to do with noise disturbances and infiltration of invasive species and human disturbance in a landscape. And interestingly, birds, we found, are more susceptible or vulnerable to roadkill than mammals on divided highways with forested medians, like the one you'll see in this picture, because they are more willing to cross narrow gaps in the landscape. Okay, continuing with linear disturbances, a couple more significant findings that we came across in our literature review is that roads are related to invasive plant species. They can serve as vectors for the spread of exotic species, especially up to 1,000 meters from the road. Also, importantly, roads affect male and female members of a species differently, which can have cascading implications for the survival of entire populations when a female, when the females of a species are disproportionately impacted. And lastly, road construction is highly related to the quality of water in a watershed. Construction can increase turbidity and suspended solid loads in nearby streams, thereby affecting the overall water quality in a watershed. And in our tables in the report, we tried to sort of separate the thresholds and targets into thresholds and targets for density, road density, and road avoidance. So I'll just touch on a few of these as examples. In one study in Alberta, found that road density thresholds for elk were about 0.62 kilometers per kilometer squared. And for road avoidance, for example, we found in a study, it was a literature review study, so it pertained to lots of different places, that species occupancy near roads severely affected by the threshold traffic volume of 3,000 vehicles per day. Okay. Patch size was the next configuration indicator that we looked at. And this was a particularly important one because many, many of our studies supported the idea that patch size provides ecological services that really can't be duplicated by any other landscape elements. This is particularly important for aquifer protection. And patch size really relates to a lot of the cover indicators that that Leif covered earlier. So the ideal patch size really varies depending on the taxonomic group or associated dispersal patterns in question. But in general, species with smaller dispersal ranges, such as plants or invertebrates, require much smaller patch sizes of less than 10 hectares, whereas larger species with greater dispersal ranges that roam across the landscape, such as predators, wide-ranging predators and large vertebrates, require much larger patch sizes for survival. Trying to move sort of quickly here since we only had half an hour slot for our presentation. My second to last configuration indicator that we covered in our report was core area and edge. And this is also related to patch size. The ratio of core area to edge is very important for a lot of interior species. Species diversity is generally higher in patches with greater percentage of interior. Large core areas have less interaction with the surrounding matrix, making it more possible for area-sensitive bird species to thrive in these areas, and it reduces the probability of exotic species invasion. Similarly, the shape of edges in a patch can facilitate different movement patterns among mammals and birds. Thinking of it in particular of several studies of birds that showed that their movement patterns responded to the shape and width of edges. They would move either along a sharp defined edge or through a softer curvilinear edge. And lastly, predation rates can be greater at habitat edges. This is found in many agricultural landscape studies. So just touching on one of these examples in that middle row of our table, a study in Wisconsin and Iowa found that amphibian species richness increased with the percentage of forest along 2,000 meters of an edge of a wetland. So this really supports the idea that the composition and the width of edges matters. Lastly, we've had several studies that were about landscape heterogeneity. This really isn't a single indicator, but rather a series of configuration measures that affects environmental quality in many different ways. It's about the diversity of landscape features and how the diversity and composition can shift and affect environmental processes in different ways. Landscape heterogeneity decreases the abundance of rare interior species in general, increases the abundance of edge species and animals that require two or more landscape elements, and enhances the potential for species coexistence. It also affects the flows of energy and biomass across boundaries, separating patches, corridors in the landscape. And when undisturbed, horizontal landscape structure can tend progressively towards homogeneity. Moderate disturbances can rapidly increase heterogeneity, and severe disturbance may increase or decrease heterogeneity. So this is a tricky one. It fluctuates a lot depending on the relative composition of landscape elements. So with that, we have just a couple conclusions from the study. The big take-home message was that there are certain patterns, really indispensable patterns, which is a term coined by Foreman in the landscape, that if protected will conserve the majority of important ecological functions. And these are patterns that we've touched on in this presentation. Again, cover and configuration are related, and the relative importance fluctuates at certain thresholds of landscape cover. In general, as Leif spoke to earlier, the proportion of native land cover in a landscape is a good indicator of environmental quality, species diversity, and riparian and watershed health. Inverse to that, the proportion of impervious surface and agricultural land cover are inverse indicators of environmental quality, species diversity, and watershed health. In terms of patch size, large patches of forest and other natural vegetation provide very important ecological services that generally can't be duplicated by other elements. And lastly, linear corridors of vegetation provide habitat connectivity, erosion control, and ensure water quality in an otherwise fragmented landscape. So with that, I think that concludes our presentation, and we will take any questions. I'll let Leif wrap up here.
I'd just like to say we're grateful for the opportunity to give the presentation, and if there's anything we can discuss that relates more closely to your own needs for this this workshop, be happy to get into them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Leif and Caitlin. Very good information. We'll take a quick minute here to see if anybody has any questions. You ask a question by raising your hand in the right-hand panel. Leslie, can we find out if anybody wants to ask a question?
Yes, sir, and I'm not seeing any hands just yet. So we'll give it a few more moments here.
Okay, Leif and Caitlin, I'll tell you the same that I've told everyone else. These webinar series have been recorded, and they will be posted on YouTube, and we will continue to use the information both as an access mechanism to our partners, but also as we develop our five-year science plan. Well, unless anybody has any questions, and I'm not seeing any hands raised.
Nor am I.
Okay, we'd like to thank all of the presenters today, and we'd like to thank all the attendees very much. Some of you we'll see in Washington next week, and we look forward to that. For those of you who can't make it, there are remote opportunities to join us via webinar and Google Hangout. If you haven't gotten that information, please send me an email, sean_finn@fws.gov, and I'll get you that information. But even if you can't participate either in person or via webinar next Monday and Tuesday during the science workshop. The process of writing this five-year science plan will continue through at least the fall of this year. And so we look forward to